Welcome back, everyone. My name is Darmari Komo. I'll be your host for today. With me, I have Mike from engineering team, and Mike's going to talk to you about in-memory OLTP. Mike, tell us who you are and where you're going to talk about today.
Okay, thanks, Darmadi, and hi, everybody. I've been answering some of your questions on some of the earlier sessions, so at least you're seeing me now, but nice to be kind of on this side of the monitor. To give you a little bit of a background on myself, I'm a program manager on the Azure CAT team, that stands for the Customer Advisory Team at Microsoft. My team was previously called SQL CAT, as you can see from my my moniker on Twitter. My team's really focused on working with customers that are pushing some of the limits of SQL Server and Azure. And over the last year or so, I've had a great opportunity to work with a number of customers who've been working with in-memory OLTP and their deployments and looking at in-memory OLTP. I've got a chance to work with some of the previous program managers a lot that you met earlier today, Kevin and Yos. And so we've gained a lot of experiences in working through that I'm looking forward to sharing with you today.
Okay, so the first question that I'm dying to ask you is in-memory OLTP works for all workloads?
Great question, and a very common one that we're getting now. So let me talk a little bit about the module overview, and I think that will flow right into it.
Okay.
So we definitely want to talk about design patterns and common design patterns that we've seen customers implement. But I think it's really important to talk first about in-memory OLTP targeted scenarios, really what the technology was targeted for.
Okay.
and looked at. And I think that will help out a lot in understanding that it's not necessarily for everything, and it's not going to make all environments just perform better.
Okay.
The second piece, obviously we'll talk about some of those common design scenarios and architectures and application patterns that customers have been implementing for in-memory OLTP. And thirdly, we'll talk about some scenarios that might trip you up, some workloads that you may just want to stay away from with in-memory OLTP because they're just not going to work as well. So again, let's start with the in-memory OLTP target scenarios. In-memory OLTP as technology with SQL Server 2014, that's really targeted at typical performance bottlenecks in the relational database management system. So when you implement the in-memory OLTP engine, the first component or building block that we're giving you is memory-optimized tables.
Right.
And the memory-optimized tables give you some unique index structures, again, really focused on OLTP characteristics, for example, the hash indexes. We also give you the non-clustered kind of ordered or range indexes as well that we talk about. So, and when you implement those particular tables, you think about bottlenecks that are common in kind of high scalable throughput relational database management systems, latching and locking are some of those typical bottlenecks. So when you implement the memory optimized tables, we get you the multi-version optimistic concurrency control, right? So we now use row versionings instead of latching and locks to take advantage and give you some more concurrency there. When you create these memory optimized table variables, we're giving you some flexibility in terms of your durability characteristics. We'll let you create them as schema and data, which gives you full durability characteristics. We'll let you create them as schema only. So you'll see some workloads that we talk about a little bit later on, which can really take advantage, right, of that kind of transient data where they don't need the data, and therefore you can create the tables as schema only and just recover the schema and then basically replay the data as needed. So it's really targeted at those typical performance bottlenecks in the relational database system.
Okay.
And in thinking about that in those target environments and really assessing your workload, it's really important to understand understand your bottlenecks that you have in your particular workload and application, and understand what your goals are too as well, right, in terms of performance. I do want to call out that Yos mentioned a utility earlier on called AMR.
Yep.
Stands for Analyze, Migrate, and Reporting Tool. It's built into SQL Server 2014, and he had a demo, I think, in one of his earlier modules on that. And that's a great tool to help you take your workload and really kind of assess where those bottlenecks are and where you can make gains for with in-memory OLTP.
Okay.
So having said that, I want to talk a little bit about testing some of the workloads and looking at your workloads a little bit to see if it kind of meets some of the targeted scenarios that we're looking at. One really critical factor is to test a realistic workload. Getting your baseline environment, whether it be with SQL Server or whatever your architecture is, and really to understand the gains after you do that migration, after you move objects into memory-optimized tables, after you move T-SQL code into natively compiled store procedures, you want to think about getting the right transaction mix. Definitely the testing under load and concurrency, and think about your table size characteristics. You want to just test at a realistic workload that you may have kind of in your systems, because that's when you'll basically experience those bottlenecks and hopefully be able to see those gains. And I think to that point, executing your workload at scale.
Right.
A number of the issues that we are looking to address with in-memory OLTP and that customers have experienced great gains with is really when they are able to exceed those scenarios. For example, if they have latching contention, they're not able to scale their environment. That's when they're seeing the big gains with in-memory OLTP. So being able to kind of test and reach that point of contention and test past that is really, really critical. So the next couple of slides, let's drill down a little bit more in terms of looking at kind of where you can get the gains as it relates to in-memory OLTP and the engine.
Okay.
So here I want to kind of go through an example that really talks about gains in in-memory OLTP. If I'm just looking at kind of a single thread performance, a single execution of code that's going against T-SQL code that's going against tables. So right here on the left, you see we have the traditional execution stack for SQL Server. We have client connectivity, we have the query execution, data access in terms of the buffer pool, and the transaction logging characteristics. For the in-memory OLTP execution stack, again, for the client connectivity piece and the transaction logging, they're basically the same. We implement with SQL Server's transaction log, and we have the same client connectivity stack. But instead of query execution, the query execution engine, now we have our procedure execution engine for natively compiled store procedures. Instead of the data access being the buffer pool, we have our data access for those memory-optimized tables and objects that we have. So if we look at some of the typical performance gains and we really want to think about where we get the gains for in-memory OLTP, really the 2 to 30x times improvements, or really most of the major improvements, are going to be if you can move and address the bottlenecks if they happen to be in basically, again, the procedure execution stack or that data access stack. So what data you move into memory-optimized tables and what T-SQL you can move into native compiled store procedures. In terms of client connectivity, in-memory OLTP does nothing to really address that. So if that is where, most of your issue is or your performance bottleneck, mm-hmm. we're not going to be able to enhance that very much. And again, for transaction logging, you end up with the same latency. We're still writing to the log for those durable tables. And we still have the same latency that's based on your disk and I/O. We do have a little bit less volume because we're not logging, for example, structures like index allocations or anything with indexing and updates.
Right.
So let's look at a couple of examples here that I think will kind of underscore this point. So in the first example, let's say I have an application. My connectivity is taking about 2 milliseconds. Execution and data access is taking about 1 millisecond. And my logging is taking about 2 milliseconds. So that's 5 milliseconds basically for a single execution. So now let's look at it. I'm going to migrate this to in-memory OLTP engine. Connectivity, I still have those same 2 milliseconds. Let's say I get 30x gains by basically moving to memory-optimized tables and to natively compiled store procedures for that component. I'm now seeing that in 0.03 milliseconds. And again, the logging is still taking 2 milliseconds. So I've got great gains on what I can move between my disk-based tables in the 1 millisecond and the execution and the data access into the in-memory OLTP engine. However, overall, for my overall execution of that particular thread, that particular unit of work, I'm getting about 20% gain. Still good, but let's look at example two. So in this example, again, the majority of my time is really spent in the execution and data access. So you can see that's 10 milliseconds out of the total 10.7 milliseconds. So again, on the connectivity and the logging, we're not seeing much of a difference. But let's say I'm able to get 10x gains by moving data into memory-optimized tables, T-SQL into natively compiled stored procedures. I go from 10 milliseconds down to 1 millisecond. Here, I'm getting about 600% gain.
Wow.
From 10.7 milliseconds to about 1.7 milliseconds. So significant gains. So what I want you to think about here is, again, just for a single particular execution, it's really important to kind of understand where your bottlenecks are and where the time is being spent in your solution, right? So if you can get, if you have a significant amount of that time being spent, or you can move basically that bottleneck into the query execution and the data access path, those are the typical components that in-memory OLTP engine can address.
Awesome.
So that kind of talked a little bit about single thread performance. I want to talk now about thinking about kind of a multi-thread performance, right? And this goes a lot to some of the other features that are scenarios that in-memory OLTP is looking to address, obviously with concurrency, latching, locking, some of those typical barriers to scale. So again, if we have disk-based tables in this particular scenario, I have a transaction one, it happens to be a writer. That transaction is going to end up taking latches out, for example, page latches. So then as transaction two, another writer, transaction three typically comes in, they're going to have to wait on those page latches to expire, basically transaction one, to actually finish its transaction, release those page latches mm-hmm. to be able to do their work. So this is a typical barrier to scale. If you kind of look what this basically happens is that in very high concurrency scale environments, as the number of threads, the number of users, the number of transactions increase that are all kind of pushing on these limits, taking out these latches, throughput kind of seems to will level off, right? Potentially even have some forms of negative scale at certain points in time, just due to those type of bottlenecks.
Okay.
So with memory optimized tables, again, because of the row versioning and the concurrency there, again, you can have multiple writers, multiple readers, transactions that are basically working on those same even rows of data, right? They may be working on different row versions, but here you get the concurrency. So in this particular case, with the in-memory OLTP engine, again, it's just really helping you be able to scale past those levels of throughput. The real critical point is if this is your this is your bottleneck, right? If scale and concurrency is your bottleneck, you really want to, again, make sure, like I talked about earlier, to get to that point in your testing. So if you just test a single execution thread and don't experience kind of the latching and locking or scale bottlenecks there, then you may not see the gains in particular as you're testing your workload, right? So you want to get to that particular point. And I just want to underscore this a little bit more with this slide. So I think Yost may have mentioned a little bit before as well that we have a AdventureWorks sample, and I have the URL down below that talks a little bit about on where you can download that from CodePlex.
Yep.
And this is an example where we converted AdventureWorks to in-memory OLTP. So I have the call that I used on a system, just the OStress call where we were using this demo insert sale orders to execute. And I executed this both on disk-based standard SQL Server tables and objects, and then the memory-optimized tables and objects with the native compiled stored procedures as well. And we varied, again, n, which is the number of concurrent connections or the number of threads here. So you can see here, a little bit different than the previous slide. Again, here, this curve up is bad because we're looking at the time to complete, which takes much longer. And you look at the time to complete for basically the disk space versus in-memory. You can see that obviously it's significantly less time to complete mm-hmm. and much more efficient when we move this to in-memory. But I really wanted to call out that, again, it just takes, we really didn't see kind of some of the differentiation between the disk-based scenario with SQL Server, which again is very efficient and fast as well for a number of these workloads, and kind of the in-memory OLTP gains until we started reaching kind of that bottleneck where we started experiencing kind of that latching or locking contention.
Right.
So just really important to think about some of that as we as you evaluate kind of your workload.
Right. This is very clear. You show us the gain in single thread and multi-threaded, and how that bottleneck exists, and how we can see the differentiation. Yes. So you alluded earlier in your introduction that you work in the team where you push the boundary for customers and all that. So you work a lot with customers. Have you seen patterns, things like that, scenarios that you can talk about for this in-memory OLTP?
Yeah. Great question, and absolutely. So wanted to just set the expectations in thinking about like in-memory OLTP and again where the gains are. But now let's talk a lot about the common design patterns that we've really seen customers kind of implement with in-memory OLTP. So let's talk about some of these application patterns. I just want to briefly comment as well that, you really want to target applications. For example, applications that are kind of hitting the wall today with SQL Server, those that are suffering from those latching and locking bottlenecks, unable to scale up, and or if you have throughput or latency SLAs that you're not able to meet with typical relational databases, or really your workload in general. In-memory OLTP engine could be extremely interesting for that type of scenario. Also, another interesting scenario we've talked to customers about and seen some customers implement and think about are kind of what I'll call net new applications. So one scenario may be a key value pair where you could use some relational characteristics. Again, the nice part about the in-memory OLTP engine is it's integrated. So you can pick those really hot data sets and move them to memory optimized tables, but then still utilize other tables in those engines, for example, to join with or to move data from the memory optimized tables to those disk-based tables to get some interesting query performance or some other performance characteristics. The second point here on scenarios where you previously may not have implemented the database in a critical path, I didn't call this out in my background slide, but I've worked with a number of, for example, financial customers, where they would typically move anything that had long latencies, which typically the relational database would be a part of that, kind of to an asynchronous write, right? So they wouldn't have it in that kind of critical I/O path or a critical path because it just took too much time. So in-memory OLTP kind of gives you an interesting solution, again, integrated into SQL Server, but can really help out because you can achieve some of those low latencies, but still get some of the relational database characteristics. So some of the common design patterns, I'll just kind of call them out briefly here, and then we'll drill down on each of them.
Okay.
Kind of the canonical scenario, again, is performance critical OLTP. In-memory OLTP is really all about performance. Second, high data input, or what we're calling shock absorber. So I'll go into that and talk a little bit about that scenario. Really, this is just ingesting large amounts of data really, really quickly and being able to handle those spikes in workload. Relational cache, this is kind of a scenario that we've seen. We're calling it relational cache, where customers are kind of utilizing the memory optimized tables basically as a cache within the engine. You may typically utilize constructs like schema only for those particular tables, again, for very, very transient data. But again, you can just implement this basically in SQL Server now. ETL target and some of the staging tables, we'll talk a little bit about that and what that means in kind of ETL-ish type workloads. And some of the read scale characteristics. So let's talk a little bit about performance critical OLTP. And I just here again, it's kind of the canonical workload. I just want to call out some of the OLTP workload, just kind of the common characteristics there. So if you think about OLTP workloads, again, it's very small interactive transactions that are requiring kind of this fast response time, high concurrency requirements. Modifications are predominantly singleton operations. Again, works very well with our hash-based indexes. And the queries are constrained to only a few tables. Mm. So we definitely support joining. But if you're really looking at really long-running reports and data warehouse query-type queries, we'll talk about that a little bit later, as that pattern may not necessarily fit. So again, OLTP in characteristics. So And working with a number of the customers, and these are just some of the general considerations and the design patterns, it's really been typically a few mission-critical tables, or I'll take that to another extent, as you'll see in the next slide a little bit, data sets. So you don't even necessarily have to think about an exceptionally large table, but really that hot data set that you may want to move into memory-optimized tables. Those are really the typical barriers to scale or require those high-throughput scenarios. Again, as well, for the native compile store procedures, mm-hmm. it's typically a targeted subset of T-SQL that you really need to look at that may be working with those memory-optimized tables. So in almost all of the implementations that I've seen, in particular, at least initially, it's basically been a handful of tables and maybe stored procedures that we've looked at. And some of the implementations, again, have had a number of tables in their particular database. But there are only a few that were really targeted to this type of scenario that they wanted to improve the performance on. And so to that point, focusing on those performance-sensitive components in the engine that can be moved. And you really want to migrate those performance-critical pieces. It may be iterative in nature on what you want to do there. Move the first ones in and potentially alleviate that bottleneck, and then see where you go from there.
So you mentioned the shock absorber. I was going to ask you what it is, but could you explain?
Yeah, I jumped ahead a little bit, but that's great. So so one of the common scenarios that we've seen, and I think that this actually underscores a number of the interesting points about how you can integrate in-memory OLTP engine, is what I'm calling high data input or kind of shock absorber. And the shock absorber, I'll put that in quotes, really stands for, we had a number of customers where their workloads really had to handle kind of either this constant high volume of ingesting data into a single table, or really some atypical spikes in the workload where you get this large spike that you need to be able to handle that data very, very quickly and either get it out to users or process it downstream.
Right.
Typically, mostly kind of insert behavior. The problem was that this may be coming from one or many clients, and in a number of cases, latching was kind of the primary bottleneck on input. They just weren't able to be able to handle that large kind of data rate. The examples that I have here in kind of my drawings, here's my example of kind of that data load, and I'm for memory-optimized tables, I'm kind of using this green glow around the tables. As we go with that. For native compile store procedures, as I have some examples later, I'll use kind of a yellow glow around that. Again, this is just kind of the base scenario here where it's implementing that memory-optimized table to basically be able to handle that heavy data inflow. But in a number of cases here, we've worked with some customers that basically need to handle this data, and it's after a period of time, they may go ahead and delete that data. However, there's a number of customers and a number of scenarios where they've kind of looked at saying, hey, I want to handle this data. I want to be able to ingest this data, but then I want to be able to move it off. And there may be a number of reasons to kind of move it off, and we'll talk about some of those. So there's kind of this option of basically pushing the data to a disk-based table, right? Mm-hmm. So this is kind of integration of the memory-optimized tables and the in-memory OLTP engine, and then standard SQL disk-based tables as well. So a number of customers have kind of implemented this particular scenario and really pushing the data to disk-based, right? So being able to handle that hot data into the memory-optimized table and moving it over to disk-based. So one pattern that we've seen is kind of hot and cold data, right? So kind of time-based scenario. And again, in doing this data movement, this is really as simple as doing a insert into the disk-based table and a select from the memory-optimized table. So we have some examples as well in some of the books online scenarios around this. Another reason that you may want to consider doing this is the memory footprint. So you may only have certain data that fits into memory, and/or you may desire scenarios like compression on the colder data. So
right.
We don't offer this on the memory-optimized tables, but we do in disk-based tables as well. We offer this with the column store feature, which is another interesting feature. And that's kind of the third workload pattern that we've seen where You want to really ingest this data and get it into the SQL engine, but you may have a mixed workload. So you may have some OLTP characteristics, but you may be doing reporting or BI queries or want to implement column store. So these type of scenarios don't map as well to the memory optimized tables in the in-memory OLTP engine, but they work really well with things like column store for in-memory data warehouse scenarios. So again, just placing just that hot data set and that execution of T-SQL into the in-memory OLTP engine can be very efficient. So that's kind of the shock absorber scenario.
Yeah, so I can think of more customers of ours are going to implement similar technology like this, yep, or scenarios like this. Do you have any result from your early customer experience that you can share with us?
Yeah, great question. So proof's in, I guess, kind of the pudding and working with a number of customers. So we worked heavily with actually an internal customer that we were working with, which implemented this type of scenario. They were able to execute on a typical workload about 4,000 business transactions a second and kind of ingest that data. But they really wanted to look at this data for real-time alerting and reporting. Right. They also had some mixed workload scenario. So they had some reporting that they wanted to do further on and aggregations they wanted to do later on. So the big problem they had was basically getting all the data into SQL Server and through their application in a more real-time manner. So they would have these atypical spikes that I talked about. They ended up getting about a 6x throughput gain. So they went from about 4,000 business transactions per second to really around 24,000 business transactions a second that they were pushing through the engine. They also got some gains on some of their queries and the reporting as well. So a really nice solution for them to be able to handle this problem and still use the memory optimized tables, the in-memory OLTP engine, and just still using SQL Server as well.
Awesome. So I also heard in conferences, especially, and then in the blogging world, there's a company called BWIN,
right,
that they've been talking about a lot about their experiences in in-memory OLTP,
right,
and their gain, especially on the area of session state. Can you elaborate what does that mean? What's that scenario do?
Yeah, great. So BWIN is great, and this I think the scenario has taken off. We worked with a number of different customers on this. So I was calling this the relational cache scenario. I think it kind of implements well with session state. Again, in this particular scenario, and I'll use the BWIN scenario as an example, really, their bottleneck is they had kind of an ever-increasing customer workload. They were using the database and kind of the single database as the scale unit for session type behavior. So lots of singleton inserts and really singleton updates and point lookups that they needed to do in managing people's sessions. And they would end up with these latching bottlenecks that cause contention, really forcing them to scale out their environment. In their particular case, I think they ended up at their high point going to about 18 servers to handle their particular workload, 18 kind of SQL Server instances. And a number of customers have had very similar session-like scenarios that they've looked to implement with this. In these particular scenarios, I call out the relational cache, the transient nature of the data. In essence, if I lost all the data in this particular case, I could probably easily recreate it. So a user may need to re-log into the system, but it's not my business critical. If I lose this data, I'm out of business type scenario. In that particular case, it kind of mapped really well to this relational cache in the BWIN case, where they were able to basically create the tables with schema only and actually avoid all that I/O. Other customers that I've seen implement this have come up with some different. So I've seen some with schema and data, and again some with schema only.
Okay.
So the BWIN gains actually phenomenal. I think in some of the early scenarios they were talking about basically 16x gains from going from about 15,000 batch requests per second all the way up to in the 200,000s. And we actually were just working with them in the lab a few months ago and got above that, more up into the 400,000 plus batch requests per second. So really, really great numbers. A number of the other customers that I've worked with, and I've worked on four or five of these scenarios, again, seeing some great numbers as well, again, in the 3x, 4x, 5x type gains for their particular solution. So amazing, amazing gains with this type of scenario. And again, just the behavior in this particular case, very OLTP centric, mm-hmm. Mostly single inserts and update behavior, really able to take advantage of the hash indexing as well for those point lookups, but using and being able to scale, right, their particular servers. So this scenario really let them really basically scale up their environment and in a number of cases basically use all the hardware that they needed to. So they were actually, in fact, able to consolidate from those 18 servers that I mentioned in the past to one.
Wow.
To be able to handle their workload today. So just some phenomenal gains with that.
Amazing. So let's move, talk about a lot of the OLTP scenarios and all that. Most of my customers, they also have data warehouse.
Yeah.
And one of the things that they want to do is obviously to move the database from OLTP to data warehouse using this process called ETL. Any scenario that you can talk about from ETL can help us?
Yeah. So, and I got asked this a little bit, I think, in one of the earlier sessions. So good questions. I said stay tuned. So here it is. So the ETL scenario, so we're calling this the ETL scenario. Again, it's kind of classic, again, data loading here, maybe from a file on disk. It may be from in memory. I'm differentiating between the high data input and the ETL scenario. Actually, a little bit more kind of ETL is typically not just inserts, but basically the customers that I've worked with are kind of doing deletes and a number of updates as well. So the goal here and really the bottleneck that they were experiencing was they wanted improved throughput, in particular in loading their data. Mm-hmm. And a number of the bottlenecks that I've seen customers experience here is kind of latching, right? Again, a number of concurrent workloads needing to ingest this data basically into these tables. So actually, you know, one customer scenario that I worked with as well, and I kind of have this over on the right side of that picture for their basic implementation, they were actually looking at doing a lot of ETL processing, but they were looking for more real time, again, through their entire workload. So this happened to be product updates and kind of basically a product catalog, if you will. They were looking for kind of this user read query workload as well as ingesting data really quickly. And they had a lot of those typical blockers, read-write blockers that we talked about earlier in high scale and high concurrency, where the users weren't really able to access the data as they were kind of doing updates. So they ended up having to scale out a lot as well. So again, on the ETL target scenario, this kind of lends itself as well to some interesting considerations. Delayed durability or schema only for the tables. Again, if you can recreate the data, if you do happen to lose it, or you're okay in losing a kind of a few records, being able to replay them from your client. And this really has given a lot of customers the ability to improve throughput and scale their reads and writes concurrently. So one of the primary customers that I was working with on this, their ETL loading on their particular scenario was for 10 million kind of loads. And again, a lot of their crunching was in their kind of that transformation was in T-SQL. So they were able to move this all to natively compiled store procs. They were able to take kind of an execution of around 10 million transactions that they had to work on that took about 2 hours, 2 hours and 20 minutes, get it down to about 20 minutes. Mm. So they're getting anywhere between 8x to 11x gains, and they were able to scale their reads and writes.
Wow.
So a really nice scenario for that. Again, in their case, the particular reads that they were doing joins on a couple of tables, but not, you know, really large reporting, long-running reporting type queries. This was for users to get relatively quick access, and so really efficiently being able to move that into natively compiled store procedures. So ETL behavior, it's still kind of a some data warehouse characteristics as
right.
well, and OLTP behavior, but some data warehouse characteristics.
Right.
So along those same lines, another kind of scenario that we've seen customers implement, and this is kind of nice, and you can actually get some of this stuff pretty quickly by using in-memory OLTP is staging tables, kind of in data warehouse type environments, or kind of temporary tables that you may be using for some kind of processing. The bottlenecks here, again, the latching that we've seen, we've also typically potentially seen I/O as a bottleneck. So this staging tables, again, they contain transient data. Usually you're able to replay it from a different data source if you happen to lose it, if the server happens to go down. So schema only can be implemented in many cases. That gives you the ability to replay the data again if it's lost. So this is kind of being able to implement the memory optimized tables can be really, really nice here again in terms of reducing the I/O and improving the performance. The one thing that I do want to call out again, when you go back and think about some of our initial considerations, if you really want to ensure that most of the time is actually being spent inside or understand how much time is actually being spent inside the engine and doing this load for this particular table. So in some ETL scenarios, if I'm working with components outside the SQL Server engine, if it takes most of the time is taken in reading data from disk, for example, then again, I'm not necessarily going to get the improvements with the in-memory OLTP engine. So again, in this particular scenario, it's helped reduce the I/O impact. I'll briefly call out temp tables just as a consideration. I mean, sometimes staging tables are used as kind of temp tables as well. Memory optimized tables can be used as this. Memory optimized table variables can be utilized as temp tables. You do need to think about kind of table versioning. Obviously, if you create a temp table, for example, in tempdb, we can kind of have some versioning characteristics where multiple people can kind of work on that at the time. And then the drop create frequency is, I think Jos actually was mentioning in his, we're actually creating DLLs behind the scene here and invoking the Visual C compiler to create these objects. So if you're expecting a really quick drop and recreate, it can be a little bit more expensive as we have to basically invoke the VC compiler, Visual C compiler to implement those tables.
Great. You've been talking about a lot of the OLTP scenarios, yes, the patterns that involve a lot of writing and things like that, even though it's short and stuff like that. How about workload like read?
Yeah, great question. Mm-hmm. This is another scenario. So obviously writes have been kind of seen, and we talked a little bit about kind of read and write behavior as well. But read scale is what we're calling kind of another scenario that we've worked with customers on. And so in this particular case, the real bottleneck is around read mostly workloads and kind of a heavy scale of users that are basically trying to implement and execute kind of similar type transactions to get at access data very, very quickly. Mm-hmm. And so this kind of goes around really reducing the latency for performance sensitive queries, I'll call it that, whether it be latency or sometimes is typically looked at as kind of round trip time or execution time of particular T SQL. And this scenario can really help in terms of consolidation from previous scale out environments. I mentioned the BWIN scenario where they were able to consolidate. I mentioned a little bit on the ETL scenario, they were able to consolidate as well, primarily from latching and locking. But in moving and looking at read scale and really looking at natively compiled store procedures, right there on some of the migration requirements, this can really provide efficiencies in terms of the instruction sets that we're looking at going through, where you can basically scale a lot more and really utilize your hardware resources. So, and that's kind of typically what people are looking at in terms of scale and read scale. A couple considerations around this that I wanted to call out. Again, one, in many cases, native compiled store procedures, you're going to want to convert your T SQL to natively compiled store procedures. The second case is, again, for the in-memory OLTP engine, and we mentioned this a little bit in kind of the shock absorber scenario moving to disk-based, is really focused on OLTP workloads. So if this is long-running reporting scenarios, that's probably not going to, again, work as well. We're going to end up potentially creating a number of row versions as you do updates while we're executing the reads, so it's going to utilize a lot more memory. And if you're really dependent on parallelism, the max DOP for working with these memorandumized tables is set to one. So just a consideration there. Or executes actually just not in parallel, will execute in a serial manner.
Awesome. So you've spent a lot of times today talking about the patterns and things like that for OLTP. Some of them touches data warehouse. Some of them touches the read. Is there any other things that our customers should avoid to look at their application before they want to move into OLTP?
Great segue. So yeah, there are, I think, just some application patterns to avoid or that I want to call out at least to consider in thinking about in-memory OLTP in your architecture. The first one that, you know, again, kind of get asked a lot, and there are going to be some changes that you need to make. At the very least, you're going to have to create the tables as memory optimized tables. Again, for the T-SQL efficiency, you want to move those into natively compiled stored procedures. So if you don't have the ability to change the code and you want to take advantage, again, of basically moving into those two green kind of points, the basically in terms of the data access for the memory optimized tables or really the native compiled stored procedures and that stored procedure execution module that I talked about earlier, you really need to think about that. So if it's, you know, you don't have the ability to change the code, that's going to make it a little bit obviously more difficult. You may not be able to see the gains or as many benefits. Mm-hmm. Hardware limitations is another. Obviously, I think we got some questions on this earlier. Basically, memory optimized tables and the data there exists in memory. So memory is an important consideration. You want to have enough memory to be able to have your data set exist, all right, and be able to be in those memory optimized tables. We talked a little bit in the shock absorber scenario about moving that data to disk-based tables. So again, there are some considerations there. Again, you want to really look at kind of that hot data set. You don't have to look at it in terms of even an overall table structure in that particular case. Disk is another consideration here. Again, when we talked about the improvements and where you get the improvements, I/O for durable tables is still really important in terms of latency. As well, for durable tables, we're going to stream the I/O on recovery from the data files. So you definitely want to think about the performance characteristics of your hardware there as well. A third component, and I know we talked again a little bit about some data warehouse-ish type workloads where you could use some of the in-memory OLTP objects. But if the workload isn't really OLTP, there may be some other technologies that are much more interesting. And/or, you know, SQL Server is I think a very well-performing engine. We've been able to get some great results from SQL Server without the in-memory OLTP specific engine. So full data warehouse workloads, long-running reporting type workloads, queries that are very heavily dependent on parallelism, obviously XML operations or full-text search, those are things that we don't have support for in the core in-memory OLTP engine. So those are some workloads to stay away from. And probably the most critical, again, this kind of goes to that earlier slide, is if the bottleneck can't be addressed basically by migrating those tables or that data into the in-memory OLTP engine or the T-SQL into the in-memory OLTP engine, if your bottleneck is outside of the components that you've moved into the in-memory OLTP engine, then there's not much that we can wholly do for you there.
Okay.
So I just want to call out quickly some of the few key takeaways. So for the in-memory OLTP engine, it's definitely a solution for applications that are suffering from a number of the common relational database management system performance and scale bottlenecks that we mentioned earlier. And we've seen some great results, really, really great results with it. We've seen a number of common design patterns where people have been able to implement successfully in-memory OLTP engine. And there are a number of different ways that you should think about assessing your workload for in-memory OLTP. Definitely understanding what your bottleneck is. We have some tools that can really help you with that.
Yep.
Migrate only the existing pieces of your solution. Make sure that you can test to and pass those bottlenecks. And basically, some applications work really, really well, and you don't have to modify a lot of code. The bottleneck just happens to be there, and you can migrate them pretty easily. There's some applications that you may have to work on, take a little bit more time, but the gains, again, could be pretty phenomenal.
So. Okay, awesome. Thank you, Mike. Hey, thank you, everyone, for joining this session. So we wrapped up this session. We'll be back in 15 minutes for another exciting SQL Server 2014 session. Thank you.